Thank you so much for coming. My name is Younhee Kim, but friends call me Yuni or Younhee. Younhee is more accurate pronunciation, though. I teach here at the Cali School of Music at Montclair State University. What I'd like to present to you today is piano works by Florence Beatrice Price, especially focusing on those of which were found in her abandoned summer house and finally printed in 2019 and 2020 for the first time. I selected today's repertoire among those recently published works. Therefore, some of the pieces are nearly debuting today's concert. Before moving on to the composer's life, I would like to share how I ended up researching Price. For example, the pentatonic second theme of Fantasie, Negre in E minor, I feel it very similar to the most popular Korean folk song, Arirang. I will elaborate more on this point later in the program. So, Florence Beatrice Price was born April 9, 1887, at Little Rock, Arkansas. She was born to Richard and Florence Smith, their mixed race family. And her father was a most famous dentist in the city, and who was a handful of African American dentists in the entire nation. Timeline of Florence, when we get to take a look at the whole life of Florence, at age of three, she began to have first piano lesson taught by her mom. At age four, first piano performance, and at age 11, her first compositions published. And I think she was very smart. And then she graduated from the high school at age 14, which is age 14 is like high school freshman now. And then she graduated already as a valedictorian. And she takes a 1-year gap before she moved to New England Conservatory. There, she double majors both piano and music education, which both of them are four-year degree programs, but she finishes in 3 years. And on top of taking lessons from the NEC director, competition professor, George Whitefield Chadwick, on top of all the like double degrees, she was taking classes, competition classes with the professor. By the way, the graduation rate at the time was less than 3%. So she must be very, very smart and intelligent. And after graduation, she returns to Arkansas briefly and teach there. But her parents were separating at the time. And after her father dies and her mom moves to Indianapolis and begins her white life. She must be white. She was a white lady. And I was told that she was despised her life in Arkansas. And that since her move to Indianapolis, there's no record how she lived. Anyway, after her father died, she didn't want to leave anymore in Arkansas, and she moved to Atlanta and teaches there for 2 years. And she comes back to Arkansas to get married with Thomas Price, who was an attorney. But after their marriage, her husband's law practice was not doing well, so she had to work and sending music for assignments, silent films or like commercials, like to make money. But because of the segregation was getting harder and like lynching place everywhere, her family felt threatened, and they decided to move to Chicago. And once she settled in Chicago, and later on, her prolific years begin. And in 1930, important success occurs at 12th Annual Convention of National Association of Negro Musicians. Margaret Bonds premieres Fantasie Negre in E minor, which I'm going to play today. And in 1931, she divorces because her husband's, like from a few years back, like her husband start like abusing her, even like pulled gunpoint on her, and then she escaped to a friend's house, where was Margaret Bond's house. And 1 month after they got divorced, she marries to Arnett, who was a insurance agent and former baseball player. But for some reason, Price didn't change her last name and just kept. And 3 years later, Arnett and Price decided to split. But in 1932, it's a great year for her. She gets national recognition by winning prize in the Wanamaker competition. She gets first prize for her first symphony in E minor. She also sonata in E minor, gets third prize. So in prize money, like $750, which is 14,500 today's money. And in 1933, this is the biggest moment of her lifetime. The president of NANM, which is like National Association of Negro Musicians, she pays $250 to Chicago to have Chicago Symphony Orchestra premiere her E minor symphony, conducted by Frederick Stock. And 1934, it was like a Great Depression era. Her financial was really struggling, but regardlessly, she decided to split. And she moved into Margaret Bunn's house and lived there for about like 3 years. And she gets her own apartment and she gets more independent. Then her very mature works composed in this time from 1930s and 40s until before she dies with stroke. She had a heart disease ever since she was a baby, and that it leads to chronic conditions. And in 1951, 2 years but before she dies, she was supposed to go to Paris, and like Paris, there the orchestra was to premiere her symphony, but she got too hospitalized and she was not able to go. Sad. This is Price. It's my favorite picture of Price. It's with nice dress, and I love her hair. And this is Price the right here with the NANM board members. Okay, now discovery manuscripts. This is a this fact is really fascinating. In 2009, some source says 2010, one of the musicologists' article, she says 2010 in her four note in her book. But mostly, most other sources say like 2009. A substantial collection of her works and papers were found in an abandoned, dilapidated house on the outskirts of St. Anne, Illinois. Like, it's all abandoned. The dilapidated house had a hole here in the roof. Many of Florence Price papers sustained water damage. And some of the Florence Price papers were strewn all over the floor after the house was vandalized. In November 2018, the New York-based firm of Schirmer Publishing Company announced their exclusive worldwide rights to Price's complete catalog. So, I feel that these recent published works, the same pieces I will be performing tonight, are Price's most mature works. So her compositional style, based on the pieces that I'm going to play today, her pieces incorporate folkloric tunes and characteristic dance elements within classical forms, emphasizing the rhythms and syncopation. It's very melodic. Her music, without melody and lyricism, it's not Price music. So this with lyric, melody, and harmonies, I think it's the most powerful way to communicate. So I can feel her personality based on through her music. She must be very passionate, straightforward. She uses a lot of sequences, which is sequences meaning like same rhythms but in different pitches. Different pitch. So like we don't repeat the each sequence same way. We have to express each time differently. I mean, she writes sequences that means she knows, she's asking her performers what to do. It's a director. And her pieces consist of mostly the American idioms revealed and reveals her southern roots. And her music, most of the pieces has a lot of direct modulation. This is one of the fact that I also feel she's straightforward in personality. Because she doesn't, when we modulate in conventional way, European conventional way, classical music, when we modulate one key to another, has to be smooth. We need to take steps to change key, but Price, one key to another, just suddenly she just go directly. So when I play for the first time her music, I was like, oh, whoa. But I realized that also could be performers' responsibility, how we could make that direct modulation more effectively that makes the piece more brighter. Then I think that was her. She must know, she's a really intelligent composer. She must have known it, but she chose to be direct. And her music also like chromatic, a lot of chromaticism and pentatonicism. And the suite that I'm going to play today, Tin Can Alley, that suite for piano reflects the way life was for African Americans in large cities at the time. And piano pieces range in difficulty from moderate to virtuosic level. I mean, in general, before even I started process piano works, I had preconception as well. Her piano pieces, mostly intermediate level or easy, or it's not as good. That was my preconception. I really feel sorry for Price, but that's not true. Her Cotton Dance, for example, published 2020, very virtuosic. It's really hard. It's difficult to play. And many difficult techniques such as
hand crossing,
large intervallic passages, her hands. So I could also see, I never met Price, but I could see Price's hand must be very big, like Rachmaninoff. She used a lot of like big intervals, like full chords, with like using like five fingers. And she seems to have easily played spending 10th. 10th mean, for example, do to do is 8th. Re, mi. So, do to C to E in one hand, which I'm not able to do. So, finally we got to first piece to perform. The title is Summer Moon. This piece, printed in 2019 during pandemic, I was so excited and like thrilled to get this music as soon as possible and perform. I'm going to record to release CDs all the programs I'm playing today, because it's just released, newly printed works, barely have recordings yet. So it composed sometime after April 6th in 1938 during Chicago here. And this is currently debuting to the public today. This piece that was dedicated to Mary Midget, who was a renowned jazz pianist and singer, also singer, and also piano student of Price. This piece shows a lot of chromaticism with mediums of jazz harmonies. You could hear the jazz harmonies in the B section. B section is like two, this is a ternary form, which is a conventional ternary form, which is a two parts. A section and contrasting B section, and the A section comes back later. So this is the structure that I wrote, and this is going to be stay while I'm playing. So you could hear the beginning is A section, beginning has the tune. If the tune repeats later, that's the last A section. And the B section is going to be recognizable because there is a pause right before. Okay, and hope to enjoy Summer Moon. Thank you. It's also published recently, 2020. This is the piano suite, which is three small pieces put together as a one set, as a set. The final version of the set may date in spring of 1937 and was most likely finalized in early 1941 based on her autograph of the address. She usually wrote her address on the composition where she and date, but some of them, a lot of them like missing dates. But based on the address, we were able to assume the composition date. And one of the most important compositions for piano solo, personally, I could feel her soul and spirit in this suite. The most mature work of all. When I compare this piano suite with her piano sonata in E minor composed way early. That piece was prize-winning piece. Who's very ambitious and virtuosic with this piece. But this piece, this suite, more mature to me. First piece is only dated. This is the piece, it's only dated piece. It's the composition date is October 1st, 1928. Like this season, like October, 95 years ago. No programmatic sketch, but titular reference to the Huckster. The title is Huckster. Huckster is a person who sells small items door to door or cart on a cart, but it's like questionable originality. The jaunty character of the main theme and periodic episodes comes like in dark. And also this syncopation, a lot of syncopations appears in the piece, but that's, I think that's a characteristic, like very common characteristic of her music, the rhythms. She likes to use a lot of syncopated rhythm, tap, tap, like with beat. There's like accents on the weak beat, which is not like one, two, three, like it is like duple meter, 2/4. Always the first beat is like has to be strong, strong weak, but like on the weak beat gets accents. That's a syncopated rhythm. And the second piece, the title of the second piece is Children at Play. Originally titled The Scenes in an Alley on Intention. But she later switched to Children at Play when she thought these three pieces went to be set together as a set. So she changed to Children at Play, describing the big city's scenes. And third piece title is Night, the dark and moody character. And there comes in the A section, there comes ostinato in the left hand. Ostinato is like rhythmic patterns. The same rhythmic patterns last for the entire A section. So, Scenes in Tin Can Alley, Suite for Piano. The first piece goes the Huckster. Hope to enjoy.
Thank you.
It reads, children at play pause to stare at an old, crippled woman who passes along searching in a garbage can for food. The pitiful figure disappears, is soon forgotten, and the children quickly resume their play. It's also ABH in a conventional ternary form. Please enjoy.
Thank you. ostinato comes in the A section, which is a sound like this.
Thank you. next piece.
Next three pieces going to be dances. First one is titled Nimble Feet, and the second dance piece is Waltz. As you could assume based on the name Waltz, right? Waltz is like from European dance court. Two out of three pieces that I'm playing today is very Price music. It's very original. You could tell this is Price music. But the second piece, which is Debutante Waltz, she wrote this for her students. So she wrote in very conventional European style. Very different from the other tunes. First of all, Nimble Feet. This is the piece from the suite Dances in the Cane Breaks. Cane Breaks is a place where enslaved people cut tough, tall grasses to clear the field to plant cotton. And for somehow, they had an energy, they left energy to death. So I think the Price wanted to describe that in through her music. So, Nimble Feet, please enjoy. The present fourth piece the use of a multiple title is common in your piano pieces. Her intention thought to be to change these titles in accordance with the particular use of the piece. And on the manuscript, there are two manuscripts were found. The red color notes, such as condensed and shortened, and make a whole grade easier, she wrote, and level off into the same grade, are written on the first page of music. And according to Barbara Jackson, musicologist, she says, this suggests that the squid was originally intended as a teaching piece. Because you would, there are three other pieces in this suite at our house, but the levels are quite different. I mean, like extremely different. The other two pieces in the suite is almost beginner level, but this piece, I could say it's kind of hard. It sounds easy and like relaxing sound, but crossing and much like large intervals, so it's definitely not beginner's level. So Debutante Waltz, and this underneath the title it says cherry blossoms in her hair. It's from the suite at our house. The problem of this piece in two of those from two manuscripts, the important marking is missing, which is Dalsenio al Coda. It has to be somewhere in the piece because she wrote senio marking in the beginning clearly, and there are coda markings in the middle of the piece, which means the missing marking is Dalsenio al Coda, meaning go to the senio marking and skip the coda section. But that marking is missing, so I didn't know where I stop and where should go to the beginning. So I tried every possible way and finally found the like coherent way, I mean coherent in structure and sound. It's rondo, like A section, B section, A, C. C section meaning like it's a different theme, subject comes. And the ABA, which is Rondo's Italian term, is like go around. So, okay, hope you to join, please. newly, one of the newly printed piece by Schirmer in 2019. I don't think this music's available to purchase yet. The date of composition is unknown, but the handwriting in the autographs is consistent with Price's script from the 1930s and 1940s. The piece references a song, Shortnin Bread, as well as the styles of the time. Shortnin Bread, I will just play the Shortnin Bread first for you to listen.
Thank you.
concert. This piece is dated 1929. This is one of the most well-known works by Price, along with the Sonata in E minor. And then the First Symphony, it's also written in E minor. I think that Price chose E minor when she used folklore elements. Maybe this is the best suiting key for her purpose, folk style. Original version titled Negre Fantasie, dedicated to Margaret Bonds. She premiered the work at the 12th Annual Convention of the National Association of Negro Musicians in 1930. This piece combines African-American folk songs and European romanticism, a style of theme and variations, with a second theme without variations. The second theme is in the pentatonic scale, same scalar basis and same similar emotional element to popular Korean folk song Arirang. I like to demonstrate the second section in this piece because that part I fell in love so much, and I feel very attached to this tune because of the similarity with the most popular folk song in Korea, Arirang. So let me demonstrate the second section first. It's key of C major. Sound like this.
Written in pentatonic scale, which is 5 notes. Melody consists of 5 notes. So today's final piece, Fantasie Negre in E minor. Please enjoy.